Hi everyone, thanks for listening to another episode of Dogman Encounters Radio. I'm Vic Cundiff and I'll be your host for the show. If you've had a dogman encounter of your own and would like to speak with me whether in private or on the show, please go to dogmanencounters.com and submit a report. I'd love to hear from you. If you've listened to the show for any time, you'll remember tonight's guest, Clara Dutcher from episode 155 titled Dogman Country. Clara, thanks so much for coming back on the show.
Thank you for having me again, Vic.
Oh, I'm so glad to have you back. Clara, for the people who missed that episode of the show, please tell us about yourself.
I'm a 53-year-old female that lives with my husband and my daughter. My son, Jared, was on episode 154. I believe it was titled Dogman in the Doorway. I have been a nurse for approximately 25 years and a firefighter for two different fire companies for 19 years. I have lived in this area my entire life except for when I moved to Columbia County, New York in 2000, and I moved back in 2016. And we now live in Stony Creek, New York, which is in Warren County.
The area where you live sure does sound like a beautiful place. It's just such a shame that you have to deal with these dogman problems.
It is. I have told Jared, which is my son's name, Jared, that was on your show, that I never believed him and that monsters didn't exist like the ones he was telling me about. It started with him when he was 5 years old, saying that for listeners that hadn't heard his show, when he was five, he had a terrifying thing happen to him while he was sleeping on the couch, whether he's sleeping or not, I'm not sure. He come running down the hall screaming that there was a huge white dog with blood all over its face and paws trying to get in the trailer that we lived in back then, and that was a silver streamline trailer. Big windows, would have had great access at any point. I told him everything was going to be okay. I was trying to comfort him while his father went out to look, and we never found anything, no blood, no nothing. And I did ask him how come the thing had trouble getting in the door, and he had told me it was too big. That was a five-year-old's take. He has had nightmares on this issue. He's 37. I misspoke last show and said he was 38. He's 37, and he has had numerous encounters over the years. These things have pestered him his entire life up here in this area, not just in Stony Creek, but in Hadley, which is located in Saratoga County, but Warren County borders Saratoga County. And we live about 2 miles over the Saratoga County line, so, you know, either way, doesn't really make a big difference to these things. I don't think they have any boundaries. And so I've been dealing with him all these years, telling him, Jared, nothing like this exists. You know, werewolves don't exist. Things that look like this do not exist. I have been out on the road with road flares and with the fire companies and car accidents and everything else. And, you know, I've heard things in the woods crunching and snapping and twigs breaking and limbs falling. But, you know, I never really thought anything about a dog man. A bear crossed the road a couple times in front of me, you know, or near me, but they, you know, pretty much just hustle right on through. They're more afraid of you than you are of them. I'm sure, you know, like with any other animal, you get a rogue bear every now and then, but there's never been one that I've ever heard of up here. And with that, I will tell you the first one that I literally seen was last August 1st, 2016, at approximately between 8 and 8:30 at night, evening. It was getting dusk, but it was still early enough in the summer where you know, all the cars have their headlights on now anyway, but I didn't need the headlights. You could plainly see the one that I seen the first time back in August 1st of 2016 walked out of the woods, just meandered across the road, and could have cared less if I was there or not, did walk down over a small embankment and then, you know, rested its hand on a log and just turned around and, you know, was scrunching up its nose at me, but I didn't really see teeth. I do remember the red eyes, as I had stated in episode 155, that they were mesmerizing to me. And I was so curious that I stopped and, you know, rolled down my car window. My husband was with me. And I just sat there probably 2 minutes at least, just looking at it. Like I said, my husband had started screaming to get out of there. I was running animals that I had seen, all types of everything, up this way, and I couldn't identify it. I had no idea what that was at that time. And I come home and told Jared, I said, I have to tell you I'm sorry because I think I just seen one of your dogmen creatures. And he said, yeah, it sounds pretty much like it. But the one in August of 2016, I don't know. It was big. It stood upright, walked on 2 feet. It was black, had a white face, or white on its face, and pointed ears. And, you know, it was large enough. It's hard to put a measurement on something as it's moving. I would say, I don't know, I think I said about 6.5, 7 foot thereabouts. And its eyes, I kept looking into the eyes. I never really got a whole lot of detail. You know, I knew that it was black and it was well kept, but it smelled. And as I had said, that it smelled like sewage, wet dog, and decaying flesh. Anybody that's ever been in the woods or walked down a road where they don't often clean up the dead animal, you smell death. And that's what I smelled from the one in August 1st of 2016. Made no movements that really made me nervous or jerky. I recall telling you it was just pure curiosity. I wanted to know what I was looking at, and I sat there running animals through my head, and the only thing I came up with was a dog man.
That's because that's what it was, unfortunately.
Yes.
Since episode 155 aired, you've been hearing some strange howling sounds you haven't heard before. Do you have wolves or coyotes in your area?
Yes, we do have wolves. We've had a black wolf and a white wolf run right down our driveway road. And, you know, they just crossed the road out here, which is called Hadley Road, and kept right on going. People were sitting outside. They didn't really do much of anything. It was nice to see them. We do have coyotes. Jared just had an experience next door to me where he had a coyote about, I don't know, 3 weeks ago come to his back door, but unfortunately his wife had thrown out something that had went bad out the back door, and anybody that lives in or around the woods will tell you, you don't throw anything like that anywhere. You know, you put it in a container and you go to the dump regularly or put it in some sort of bear-proof type container. However, I have to say recently, Vic, that I have seen bags of trash ripped open on the sides of the road where the containers are knocked over, and not usual like that. I haven't really seen a lot of that around here until just recently. So there are coyotes. They're coy dogs. Have I ever heard these wolves howl? No. The coyotes yip and yap. The coy dogs do the same thing. they sound like they're crying, like, you know, but you can tell there's like 25 of them.
Do the howls you've been hearing sound like they could have been made by wolves?
What I have heard will make your hair stand on end. I watch a lot of nature shows in true life, like Nat Geo and stuff, and any howling that I've ever heard from wolves, it's more like a mournful howl. Yeah, it could be creepy if you were out there by yourself, maybe a little bit, you know, you make your campfire a little bigger. But other than that, what I've been hearing and my daughter heard and my son as well has been hair raising. I mean, whatever it is, it's close and you can tell it's big. It is big. And I never really wanted to know just how big. And it scared me really bad when I have been hearing these howls. They're long and drawn out. And usually a wolf, from what I have seen, they'll howl to one another to locate other, I don't know if it's other packs, but you hear more than one howl. This is one howl over and over and over until you just turn up the TV and pray to God that something is not going to come through your door or through your window or rip the side of your house off. Engine brakes on a truck, a Jake brake is what I can compare it to. After it gets out, the first screech that it makes, the really deep, throaty, guttural howl. And then after like 10 or 15 seconds of that, it sounds like a Jake brake on a 18-wheeler, or in my experience also with 18-wheelers too, but fire trucks have Jake brakes, air brakes, and, you know, the Jake brake, the engine brake, which slows the truck down when it's coming into a, usually into a community, so it don't wake people up. I don't know why they do that, because the Jake brakes are louder than the trucks themselves, but anyway, to slow it down. That's been my experience. This thing, I haven't heard. I've heard the same howl, but it happens over and over and over, 5, 6, 7 times in a row. It does not sound like it's more than one. It stays in the same spot. When you hear it and it's that close, it's in the same spot. We've heard it several times, a little bit of a distance away, but not that far. Nothing ever answers it back. Everything goes silent. Nothing makes a peep. Nothing. There's no peepers like the frogs that peep, whippoorwills, or any type of other animal sound out there that you might hear at night. So other than that, I really would have trouble trying to describe it any different than like somebody just hitting a Jake brake as it's going right by you, and it makes your whole body just shake. You can feel it vibrate inside your body.
If hearing howls like that doesn't make you want to have a Century 21 moment, I don't know what will. Let's talk about your encounter now. It happened yesterday, actually. Please give us every last detail that comes to mind.
Oh, okay, Vic. I got woke up yesterday morning. My sister had lost a good friend, and so I was up early for me, and you know, I said, well, I'll be right down there. So I went down. I didn't get there until noon, but I remember my daughter calling me, and it was 4:30, and she goes, I thought you're only going to be gone for a couple hours. And I'm like, okay, I'll start home, you know, and we needed a couple things at the store. And for people who don't understand what going down street means up here, we don't have like your little, there is one little corner store if you can afford to buy anything out of there. We try to keep our business as local as possible. But sometimes, you know, it's just realistic. You have to go down street. And I've had several people say, what do you mean by going down street? Down street to us is a 12-mile one-way trip to the store and back. There's no gas station up here. So you get everything you need. I try to get everything I need for, at the minimum, 3 days, and a week if there's going to be a storm. But running down the street isn't an easy task. It's not just something you walk across the road or down the block and there's one there. There are no blocks up here. It's all one road. And so I went to the store while I was down there, and I want to say it was between, probably by the time I actually left, my sister's house was probably between around 5 o'clock yesterday evening. And I ran to the store real quick. I only had to grab like 4 or 5 things, milk and some soda and bread, I think it was. But I came right out because I was tired and wanted to get back. It had been a draining afternoon with my sister. And so, again, for the listeners who may have or may not have listened, it was the same road that I live on, which is Hadley Road. It starts in Hadley. Hadley's just a little hamlet of a town, just a little, not much of a town itself, but it's bigger than Stony Creek. I live in Stony Creek. So Hadley Road starts in Hadley, and it's still Hadley Road when it gets to Stony Creek. That being said, that's where last August 1st, 2016, I had my first encounter with the one I had just described to you. Yesterday, I did not have the windows down on my car. It was kind of cool. I just wanted to get home. And I was about, I would say, 3 miles from my home, which is about 1 mile before I got to the Warren County border. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, I just see this flash of black, and I just slammed on my brakes. I didn't see anything there as I was approaching. All of a sudden, I am looking at this thing standing in front of me, and I am like, oh my God. I'm like, please, dear God, not again. And this time, there's no more curiosity, Vic. I'm interested, and I will continue to listen and gather what information I hear. You know, take it all with a grain of salt. But this thing just was right in front of me. I never seen it on 4 legs. It was standing upright on 2 legs. It was black, and it looked like somebody took like a paint-by-numbers paintbrush and put it in some tannish brown paint and might have painted a couple little, maybe 1 or 2 inch streaks on it. And it literally turned and faced my car. It couldn't have been more than 3 foot in front of my car, because all I could see of it was the backward facing part of its calf hock. Not even sure what these creatures' animal parts names are. And it literally darkened the inside of my car from the size of this. I had come to a complete stop, and this is still fresh, so I'm still a little shaken up by this. I had to literally bend down, as people know from episode 55 or 155. If they don't, I drive a Camaro. So they're short cars. They aren't tall vehicles. They're low to the ground. And so I had to lean into my dash and look up. And what I seen, Vic, made my blood run cold. I have a cross that hangs from my mirror, and it's a big cross. And I remember just sitting there saying the Lord's Prayer numerous times to myself. And I'm like, please, dear God, please, make it go away. You know, and I reach up and I'm holding the cross and I'm looking up. And as I'm looking up, this creature that I know to be a dog man at this point, was standing there, and like I said, it had turned to face my car, and I could tell that it was a male. It had the genitals of a male, like a big dog would. The fur seemed thinner on what would be the underside if it was on four legs. And as I'm looking at this thing, its ears were laid right back on the sides of its head. This thing was enormous thick. It had to have been at least 8 foot tall. I had to literally lean all the way into the dash, and I am like looking up at it, and it was black. Did not have my windows down this time. Did not roll my windows down at all. I didn't care what it smelled like. I didn't need a clearer view. I'd just come from the car wash the day before. Everything was clean in the car. Nothing dirty on the windshield. I wasn't seeing things or anything to that effect. And I looked into the face of what I thought looked like pure, terrifying evil. And as I'm sitting there, for what seemed like an eternity, I'm just staring at this thing. I don't know. It came out from the right side of the road. Again, I was on the right side of the road. And there's trees and brush and stuff. And there's railroad tracks. And beyond that, again, is the Hudson River, which, you know, meanders down through. I have no idea why it stepped out in front of me. At that point, I really wasn't even thinking of that. I was just like, how many of these things are here? It had to have been, and I'm not exaggerating when I say 8 foot tall. And it was so muscular, it's hard to even describe. Like I said, the fur seemed thinner on what would be the belly of it. I seen the upper legs, the thighs, and mid-calf. About mid-calf up is about what I could see from looking straight ahead. I'm still nervous, and I do apologize to all the listeners for that. It's so fresh in my mind that I thought I was done. I really did. It just looked pissed. Pissed off that I was there, like I had interrupted something. I have no idea what. I had spoke to my son Jared about this, and he said, well, maybe there could have been a group of them hunting. He's seen them in multiples. And I didn't look. I didn't care what was coming from the right side, because whatever it was already in front of me that was enough to take care of me right there. I thought I almost soiled myself, to be quite frank. And I am like, I'm the teeth. This time I seen teeth. It had canine teeth, but it wasn't like a dog or any wolf that I've ever seen canine teeth on. It had like three sets of canines, because I was trying, after I got my senses back, let me put it that way. I didn't overcome my fear at all. I could see multiple teeth. It looked like it had three sets of canines, and the largest being the four front and the very front canine teeth, and they were curved inward. And then it had two more. Each one, I would say the first set, that I seen were at least 2.5 inches long. And I just stared. The other ones got a little shorter as they went on. And then there was just a bunch of other teeth in its mouth that you could tell was used for grinding, killing, ripping, tearing, shredding, anything you can think of. All I could think of would be like a starving wild animal would dive on something and just start ripping it and try, you know, swallowing it in pieces without even really chewing it. It was big enough to easily wipe out anything I have ever seen in the wild up here. Or anywhere in the wild. I've not been well traveled, but I have done the eastern, a little over the Mississippi line, but not much. And Texas and Maine, Canada. My son says he thought that they could have been traveling in a pack to hunt. I could not see the eyes. It just, like I said, it was so happy standing there showing me its teeth that I couldn't see eyes. It was like squinting because I'm sure it was growling. I'm sure it had to have been doing something, but you know, my car is a muscle car, so I kind of have a kind of throaty exhaust on it, and the radio was on, so I didn't hear anything, but it did not look happy at all. Just really, really pissed, like, who the hell are you in the middle of my road? Is the way I felt. I felt like the outsider.
Oh, I'm sure you did. How did that dogman compare physically to the dogman you've seen before?
Well, the one that crossed the road in front of me that just meandered about, it was new to me, and to me that was big. This thing dwarfed it. It dwarfed it in every way imaginable. Height, weight. I have seen 600-700 pound bears that have been hunted and hanging, and it make them look like boo-boo. This thing was massive and muscular. The chest was hairy. It was very well kept. It was clean. And like I said, I didn't catch an odor. There was no way I was rolling down the window at all. I was that scared. I was alone, first of all, which I don't think it would have mattered because my husband probably would have had a heart attack if he had seen this one. I'm glad he wasn't with me, because if he had been and he started screaming or in any way dragged its attention for one split second, I'm just praying, go away, go away, go away. And of course it stood there. So I got some of my senses back and I'm like, okay, start looking for details, you know, get the details. And like I said, the teeth, huge. Ears, pinned back, they looked huge. His head, and when I say this, its head had to have been 3 foot wide. And with a snout, oh my goodness, I'm saying its snout was at least 6 inches wide. I wasn't going to take the measuring tape out of the trunk and measure it, but after working the way that I've worked with the fire companies and as a nurse, you know, you pretty much get used to measuring stuff and you can eyeball a lot of things. The muzzle, I bet you it stuck out. It had to have stuck out a foot. Easy. It seemed like to me, from the best that I could tell. And I did not want to see anymore. You know, at that point, I'd seen enough, but it wasn't moving. So I'm sitting there just staring. And like I said, I did not see eye color. I couldn't. It was just so scrunched up with the nastiest sneer. It was just like you have walked into a yard of Rottweilers or something, like in a junkyard dog would come at, you know, that's all I could think, how they would show all their teeth. Well, this was showing me its teeth. I don't remember seeing a tongue, but I didn't think I was going to see anything again after that.
Oh, I'm sure you didn't. When it was standing there in front of your car, did you ever think about trying to run it over?
Yes. I'm like, okay, what if I just punch it? However, like I said, it was between its feet and its knees. What damage was I going to do at 3 foot away from it? You know, if I just punched the car, I just think I would have really been in trouble if I had tried to do something like that. I thought about blowing the horn. Again, my mind's going ding, ding, ding. You don't blow your horn around moose. You know, they've been known to attack cars. And I did. I was thinking, why couldn't I be in my daughter's Ford Explorer? Why? You know, why do I have to be in this car? This is just nervous chuckling. Nothing funny about this thing at all. Nothing. Nothing funny. Nothing cute. Nothing that I am curious about either.
Yeah, it doesn't sound like there was anything funny or cute about that experience. Did it ever make any movements that gave you the impression it was going to try to remove you from your car?
As I was leaning up looking at it, I felt like it was bullying me. Because it, like, bent its head over the hood of my car. Its body still didn't touch my car. And it just made sure I got a really good view of all those teeth. And I'm sure I seen saliva, but its mouth appeared wet. The teeth were glistening. I don't recall seeing tartar build up on them or nothing. And I know I give my dogs beef bones to chew on to clean their teeth. So I have 6-year-old dogs that have clean teeth. And this thing's teeth were as white as a pure driven snow. I didn't see yellow. I didn't see any breakage. I didn't see anything. And then it was twitchy. Its arms were twitching. And that's when I'm like, oh, don't forget to look down at the hands. And that's when I realized that they weren't paws, they were hands. And I came home and measured my fingers. My longest finger, and I'm 5'9", I'm not a small person. I weigh around 200 pounds. But my largest finger is 3.5 inches long, and that's my middle finger. And its fingers had to have been 7-8 inches long. And on the ends of those fingers, it had claws on it like a grizzly bear. And I say that only because from Columbia County, there's a particular store down there that has, where the owner went out and hunted a grizzly bear. And people who have listened to me before know that I'm a bear fanatic. I love bears, and I used to go in there all the time, and I'd put my hands down between its toenails, and I would look at that in amazement that its claws were like an inch longer than mine, my fingers. So 4-inch, 4.5-inch claws on this thing, making, and I know this sounds totally off the wall, I don't know the size of its palm from the wrist to the beginning of its fingers, other than to say that it just sat there and clackled, like was twitching its fingers, almost like somebody that's nervous would tap their fingers on a desk, you know, the tappity tappity tap. I could imagine that's what it would sound like if it could hear over the growl, which I'm sure it was doing something because it was taking breaths through its nose, not panting. And I became really nervous, and I felt like, yes, I was in danger, severe danger, because I didn't know anybody who could have been coming up or down the road that could have done a thing. I've never seen anything this big. I have seen animals in zoos and stuff like giraffes. I'm not even talking like that. I am just talking big, wide muscle. You could see the muscles just rippling in its thighs and across its chest and in its arms. And I'm like, oh, God. You know, he's going to come right through the windshield. He's just going to reach right in, and he's just going to take me right out. Don't take much. My door isn't all metal. It has the window doesn't have a metal casing around it. Only if you put it down does it go into the door. So all I would have had to done, it could have popped my car window with no problem at all. Nothing. Nothing. And there would have been nothing I could have done. Nothing. Except for try to run it over, because there was no getting around it, at least on the right side. And it just scared me. I am still frightened of what is in these woods.
And for good reason. Yeah, that would have shaken anyone up. You said it had 4.5-inch claws, Clara, but what color were they?
They were mostly black, but you could tell, like, the undersides of them, like I said, look like a grizzly bear claws. Darker. The tops of them look like a tarry black, but you could tell the difference from the claws and the fingers, because underneath the claws was a lighter color. Not quite brown, but a little lighter, you know, a darker tan, like maybe somebody who takes their coffee kind of on the light side, about that color. But the top parts of the nails were black. And I could see the distinct lines underneath the nail as it came down through. And it was like a light tan color.
You think it might have been lured to your car. Why do you think that?
Well, my car got hit, and it broke my driver's mirror, so I had to get new mirrors put on my car. And they whistle now. They never whistled before. And when I say whistle, like when you put those deer whistlers on your car, and I had put them on my Camaro when I first got it, and a truck driver that was in my fire department, he goes, take those things off your car. And I'm like, listen, I don't want to hit a deer, you know. And he goes, let me ask you a question. He goes, what do you do when you hear a sound? I go, I turn and look. He goes, exactly. And I said, okay. So I took them off and never had a problem, knock on wood, with hitting a deer. These whistle so bad, if you put your window down, it drives you insane. I don't know why they do it. You know, nobody else can tell me why they do it. They just whistle, just like a deer whistle as you go down the road. And it's a high pitch. It hurts my ears. And I'm thinking maybe it just pissed it off enough for it to step out and say, wait a minute, not on my road.
That might be why it came and visited you that day, but I think more than likely it was just a case of being at the wrong place at the wrong time.
I'm sure. I was just hoping against hope that it was something as minute as that. But, yeah, horrible. Horrible. Now I know the fear that Jared knows.
Yeah, you do know it now, that's for sure. You said it was at least 8 feet tall and was heavily muscled, but how wide do you think it was?
Oh, God. Well, my car is short and squatty, and I'm thinking maybe 5 foot across his chest. His head was like 3 foot, and it had a good foot on each side of its shoulders, it was just rippling. All I could think of is like Lou Ferrigno, the bodybuilder there, the Incredible Hulk or whatever, or Mr. Atlas type muscles. I mean, it was muscles on muscles. The only thing it didn't do was flex its pecs at me.
Well, thank goodness it didn't do that.
No, I know.
Did you notice whether it had a tail or not?
Yes, I did. It had a big, bushy, black tail that was the other one I thought was about 3 foot long on the first one that I seen back in August of 2016. This one appeared to be about 4 foot long. Wasn't wagging. It wasn't tucked between its legs, but it did have a curve to it. Big, bushy, bristly-looking thing.
That had to be something to see.
Well, I'm really thinking about a dash cam, because how do you explain this to people? All you can do is give them your best estimates, and I am not, like I said, I'm not small. And this thing, I had to bend over and look up at it. And like I said, it made the inside of my car dark when it was there. It was hard to see, like, from my side windows, I knew it was daylight. Obviously, it was still daylight. I'm trying to think of a good way to guess, but it took up most of my windshield on my car, across it. I had to turn my head from side to side to look at the whole thing, and up and down.
It sounds like it must have been quite the physical specimen. Did you notice any other physical features you haven't mentioned so far?
I did notice that its nose, its nasals were flaring back and forth as it was breathing, and I could see it breathing well. Like I think I had said earlier, it looked like it was about 6 inches across the nose of it. The muzzle, it wasn't a nose. It had a nose, but not just the nose, but it was wider at the head part, and it got narrower, but it never really got much narrower than about 6 inches. If I had to put a tape measure around the whole muzzle up by the face, Vic, I don't know, we're talking probably 18 inches maybe. And I know that sounds extreme, and I'm sitting here and I got tears in my eyes. Yeah, you know, just like you would measure a man's bicep, but it was just massive, heavy duty, beyond heavy duty. I wouldn't want to hit this with fire truck or a tractor trailer, to be honest with you. And it did have a ridge of hair going down its back and around its neck. It had not like a lion's mane, but more like you would see like on an elk. Elk, I think, have the heavier fur around their neck, or caribou. And that was black. Fairly decent length hair, nothing I want to comb or prune, but I would say the hair on its back and around its neck, I would say was probably 6 inches long, but the rest of the hair on it might have only been a couple inches long. The arms, the hands, the fingers on it had hair.
How long did it stand in front of your car before it moved off?
What seemed like forever. I didn't look at the clock, Vic. Minute, maybe, 30 seconds, a minute, maybe 2 minutes. I just lost all track of everything. I was just staring at this thing I thought was going to kill me. And I really had no doubt that if I had even attempted to open the door or roll down the window, that that's exactly what it had its intentions on doing. The chest on it kind of, I don't want to say V-shaped or pointy, but not exactly flat either. But it did come out a little bit. It was wide, and then it ended up getting a little narrower towards the underside of it. What I would call the underside if I seen it on four legs, but I didn't. It was only on two. You could definitely tell it came down at an angle like it had a waistline, and then the legs just protruded right out. I mean, the legs were massive, as was the whole thing. I don't even know how big to say the legs were. I really was kind of just concentrating on the claws and the head and the face, and nothing on this thing was small, nothing.
When it finally moved from in front of your car, what did it do?
It went from the middle of the right-hand lane, and it took one leap, and it was on the opposite side off the road, probably 10 feet off the road, maybe. It moved so fast that within 2 seconds at the most, 2 or 3 seconds at the most, it went into a clearing where the trees were smaller. It was like Poison Sumac, and it went right into that. It didn't bother that at all. And all I could see was like the trees just shaking, and I'm like realizing I'm still sitting there, and I'm like looking at these trees going, why all of a sudden am I seeing these things? And it just seemed to vanish. I did not see nothing from it after that. However, last night I had to take my daughter to the hospital. Therefore, I had to go back outside around midnight. And as soon as we, and I say we, my daughter and I stepped out the door, there was that howling sound that I had described earlier that we've heard off and on up here. This time, I yelled for Jared. Jared came out with a flashlight, and he goes, Mom, I already heard the howling. He could hear it over his TV or game system or whatever he had on. And he came out with a spotlight just to make sure that we got to the car okay. And then, to be honest with you, he wasn't, I don't think, very comfortable doing that either. But he's my boy, and, you know, he puts Mom and sister first, and he's gotten used to it, he says, over the years. But the howl would give anybody the chills, at the very least. I mean, my hair went, I'm like, oh, my God, we got to go back down that road. And I'm sitting in the car. I didn't want to leave. I'm like, I didn't know where this thing was. I didn't know if it was the same one. But like I said, it was the same howl repeated 5-6 times maybe that I heard. God knows how long it had been going on, because in my house we have 2 separate TVs going a lot, and I wasn't really paying attention because I didn't want to have to take her to the emergency room. You know, you got to do what you got to do. And then when we got in the car, I'm like, you do realize I got to go back down the road, the same road that 6 hours before that this thing was standing, and now we're hearing this howling. And I was just terrified.
Oh, I'm sure you were. Yeah, it took a lot of guts to drive down that same section of road just 6 hours after you had that nightmarish experience.
Like I said, there's not a lot of roads up here to change your path when you're headed out of town. so to speak. I had to go down into Hadley, so I had to go down Hadley Road, and the other options are just as bad. Either way, you're going to be on a lonely stretch of highway, and at that hour of the night, there's not much traffic at all. There was traffic before I had come up Hadley Road yesterday afternoon, but they've been doing a lot of road work and stuff, and I think cars are trying to take ulterior routes if they can, because they're putting in new culverts and stuff. And I didn't want to go back. I said, can't we wait until tomorrow? But she was having an allergic reaction, so she had to go.
Yeah, sounds like your hand was forced. That's really tough. Did you see it drop down on all fours at any time?
Never, no. It had no problems on two legs. I have yet to see one on four legs. I don't care if I ever see another one to find out if it isn't on four legs or not. I'm sure it wouldn't have a problem doing that, but I don't know. I can't say for sure. I did not see that. Where it went off the road into the wood line is a straight mountain. Perhaps that was the reason. I don't know. I didn't see it. I sat there, like, not long. Once I realized, I just started moving, and then if I could have done 150 on this road, I'd have been home in record time, but you can't because it's really curvy, and, you know, you don't know what else is going to jump out in front of you. And at that point, I didn't want to wreck my car by being overly stupid, but I didn't let the grass grow under the tires either.
Well, I don't blame you there.
I just got out of there. I kind of rolled away at first, and then I'm like, what are you doing? And then I just stepped on it and got out of there.
Well, I don't blame you. Now that you had this most recent encounter, have you thought about moving?
No. I know that probably sounds ridiculous to a lot of other people, but like I said, you know, my family born and raised here generations. It's not so easy to up and move, you know, find a new location. We love the woods. We love the animals in the woods. We just prefer not to have the dogmen. And I feel that the dogmen will find you anyway. I know they have with Jared, and I am most certain. I'm not sure. I don't think the same ones follow you. They could. I don't know that. I'm just thinking that they're all over the place. They have to be. I don't know how else to say that other than I know a couple people, three or four people that have noticed them down in Columbia County. So I don't think that they have followed us up here. I think whatever's here has been here. Like I said, I don't even know what these things are. I've heard people say they're Nephilims. They're aliens, they're a figment of your imagination, werewolves, or, oh, you just seen a bear. Even the skin on it was black colored, along with the hair, from where I could see down near its private parts where there was not much hair, but the skin still seemed to be dark black. That was all about the best description that I can try to give you, other than, like I said, some faint brown markings, which I don't even know if it was fur. It could have been mud. I don't know. It didn't look dirty. It was well kept. It was very well kept. Up here, there was a deer we've been watching for the last, month, 6 weeks or so on the side of the road. It's been in the same place all the time. It's on one side of the road or on the other side of the road, but it's all just standing there chewing away, and it's a large area. I'm going to say with a quarter of a mile, it's all in that one area. Well, suddenly, no more deer. I have not seen that deer, and it was distinctive. It was a coppery color. It was beautiful, and we all admired it, and we would take rides in the evening to go and look at it, and it was always there. I've seen maybe one or two deer out by the edge of the road at all most of the summer, and they're all over up here. I don't like to remain in fear of something. I don't want to be terrified to live my life and to go on in fear. However, I will always, always, always be aware of my surroundings. You can count on that. But I did take a ride tonight just to try to overcome my fear. And I thought, well, let's go look for a bear. I can deal with the bears. I want to go hear the bear. You can hear the bears howl across this lake at one another. No mistake in them. I mean, you know, they're like, you know, you can hear them across the lake. And you're sitting on the road. You don't even have to turn your car off. And, you know, I pushed it a little farther. I actually went to the top of the mountain and down about 2 miles or three down the other side of the mountain till I felt like, well, okay, you know, it's about that bewitching hour here. My daughter was with me, and we got out by the lake. I stopped the car and pulled over. You could see a couple other trucks by the lake, so I wasn't too worried. I was scared. I'm not going to lie to you. I was scared, but I wanted to get out because this one tree looks like it's been dug by a bear, and you can tell. I mean, I could reach my hand up with no problem, and you can put your fingers into the creases of the bear claws. But black bears have short claws. They don't have long 4.5-inch claws. They might have 1.5, 2 inch, if that, but they're very sharp. And you can tell. I've seen enough bear scrape. You can tell. They had one log torn apart where they were eating the, I'm assuming termites, that's what it looked like to me. I'm not a bug expert by any means, but I was hoping to find a bear rub, like where it scratched its back and stuff, because I wanted to, you know, like, look, I found a tuft of hair. Aren't you proud of me? I faced my fears and I've lived through it, but I don't want to ever travel alone, and I will never, ever go any place again without telling somebody. I said before that I wouldn't mind walking into the woods. I wouldn't mind still walking into the woods. Like I said, I have a bad hip, I told on the other show, so I really cannot do that. Even trail walking, it wouldn't stop me if I could. I just would make sure that I'm not going on top of any mountain and just start bushwhacking my way through the brush and going someplace that I don't know. I told my husband, I said, from now on, I'm giving you a destination point, the way I'm going, the way I'm coming home, because if something happens to the car, I am not getting out and walking. And I don't even want to walk on this road now in the daylight, because I've seen two in the daylight, roughly about within a couple hours at the same time of the year. And as on episode 155, excuse me there, I had seen something where it had crossed the road. My daughter was driving her Ford Explorer, and I was in the passenger seat, and I was looking at stuff that I don't usually get a chance to look at. You know, as a driver, you can't glance up the side of a mountain all the time. And so all the leaves were down, and you could see where this thing walked right across the road. And I had said before on episode 155, the snowbanks had yet to be pushed back, and they were about 4.5 foot high. And I could not see where this thing had stepped over the snowbank, but I could follow two distinctive tracks with my eyes all the way up probably 200 to 300 feet up. And I don't even think it was 300 feet because I have stopped and looked there not too far off a few weeks ago, and I'm like, oh, that's not 300 feet. But whatever was standing up there was black. It had a big bushy tail, pointed ears. It was not a bear. Bears have rounded ears, and they're short. And like I had said before, my daughter Laura refused to turn around. And Jared, I don't think I mentioned that he was in the vehicle too, and he seen the same thing, but she didn't want to turn around. The roads were horrible. I can't blame her, but you know, we did have a little squabble over that because I'm like, I want to go see those tracks. And I've been stopping my car alongside these roads, getting out looking for tracks. So with that, I found I don't have to go very far to find tracks. My neighbor told my husband, he goes, come here and look at this bear track. Well, it was in my neighbor's yard. And, you know, I try not to intrude on people. We like our privacy. That's why we live up here. You know, we like it. We love the woods. We love the wilderness. We never knew it came with dogmen. Nobody ever told me about that. My grandmother always told me, be careful. I had to come in every night when I was little, but I had been out of the car looking for bear tracks and stuff on the side of the road thinking, okay, you know, I seen a dog man, didn't seem too bad. It, you know, didn't look the happiest, but it didn't look like it was going to tear me from limb to limb. But this one did. And the one that I seen, we seen, I should say we, pretty much my family, everything except for my husband, seen, Jared and I actually are the ones that seen it in the winter. Bears don't have big bushy tails. Wolves don't walk on their hind feet and stand there in the middle of a hill that sloped upward with its head looking down at you. I could not make out distinctive features other than I know that had a muzzle and it had pointed ears and a big bushy tail and it was black and it was not small. And hopefully when Jared will get a chance to talk to you, he could probably reiterate pretty much the same thing that I'm telling you. But my neighbor come over and got my husband, say, come here, I'll show you a bear track. And my husband went over. So he comes over all excited, you know, and up here, we're rednecks and hunters and, you know, we live off the wilderness and down there, you know, you can lasso a deer. I used to hit deer off my front porch with a broom because they'd eat my flowers out of my baskets. And I'd be like, this isn't hunting, you know, and it would just stand there looking at me as it's eating my flowers. As soon as I closed the door, it was right back. I didn't know there were dogmen down there at that point either. But he comes back all excited. Honey, honey, he goes, you got to come and see this. Our neighbor just showed me a bear track. I want to show it to you. And I said, well, where is it? And he goes, well, it's over here in our other neighbor's yard. And for their anonymity, I'm not going to say their names. But I walked over it. And I'm like, really, Dan? That's my husband, Dan. That's not a bear track. We have rabbits here all over the place. My neighbor that come to get him to show him the bear track somehow has lost control of his bunny population. They have now mated with the wild rabbits, and it's like cottontails everywhere. And you could tell. I mean, I could tell instantly by looking at that. It was only two little scratches in the dirt, and I said, Dan, that's not a bear track. I said, that's not even close to a bear track. And I was looking around, and I said, did you notice this? And he goes, what? And I go, look. And it was a dog print that was somewhere around the size of a softball. And it was distinctive. I have a golden retriever, and she got big feet. Not even close. Not even close, Vic. This track, and I only seen one, and then I got a little nervous. This was earlier this summer, around the time that somebody had stopped, and I'll get to that part. We had a yard sale here, but it was after that event. I am like, that's not a wolf track. I go, it's not a bear track. The wolves, the two that we seen, left tracks. Yeah, they were good size. They might have been maybe 150 pounds apiece, maybe, give or take. But the tracks on these were a little bit bigger than my golden retriever. this thing was the size of a softball. But I only seen one track, but that don't surprise me because I have a feeling it just grabbed a bunny for a snack. And that's what the two scratch marks were. And there's so many of them, who knows? It's hard to tell. And I couldn't find anything further. I just found that one large track. Now, we all know dogs don't walk on one foot too often. And if it does, it's not going to be that size. We did have a man pull up here during a garage sale asking us if anybody here had ever heard of dog men and if anybody had seen any. And the man that we're buying our home from told him, you need to talk to that man over there and his wife. And I was not outside at the time. He told my husband he was writing a book. But yet, when my husband tried to explain to him what a dog man looked like, or asked him what a dog man looked like, I believe he said he asked him first what he thought a dog man was. He really didn't give any indication that he knew what he was talking about. I'm not saying he didn't, or maybe he just wasn't letting on that he did and wanted information. And that's when the owner of my property said to him, he goes, you want to find out what's going on in these woods, or if there's anything around here, he goes, take a challenge. He goes, I challenge you to go backpacking. He goes, go up the road about 12 miles and take a left. Go to the top of the mountain. Go in and just camp for the night and see how you make out in the morning. He goes, because there's things here that people would never believe. So somehow I think we're in the heart of dogman country up here.
Well, it sure sounds like you are. And it sounds like I named that one episode, episode 155, correctly, too. Why were you so shaken by this most recent encounter when you handled your previous encounter so well?
Well, I was scared. I was in extreme close proximity to it. Before, it probably crossed the road in front of me. I seen it coming out of the woods, and it just meandered. It didn't look at me. It didn't do nothing. It just walked across the road, just like a two-legged person would, really. But it was no person. It was no person in a costume. That I'm positive of, because when it did cross the road, and I stopped directly across from it, and I didn't see teeth. I really couldn't make out the, I think I called them hands, paws, or claws back then. I couldn't understand. I'm thinking, really? I was running every animal through my mind, and I could not come up with anything, but I did have to come home and tell Jared that I think I just had a dogman encounter. And this one, there's no mistaking this thing. There is no mistaking it. I've done a lot of horseback riding in the woods. Our family owns a huge riding stable in the area. I can no longer ride, but right now, I don't think you could pay me to go on a trail ride. I was a trail guide for years for my grandfather, and this thing scared the crap out of me.
Yeah, that's not hard to understand. Well, it's about time for us to get out of here, Clear, but before we do you have any closing comments you'd like to share?
Just a couple, Vic, and I don't mean to continue too long here. I just wanted to let you know that it didn't look like its lips could go around its teeth. I don't know. It was just so toothy that I don't know how it could have stretched its lips around its teeth. Don't think these things can't hurt something, because we aren't seeing deer. We aren't seeing the wolves anymore. We aren't seeing the bobcats. We have not heard a bobcat at all. Even the bears are not that many right now. And I have a feeling that these larger predators that are dogmen are wiping these animals out, or trying to. There's fish, there's fresh water, everything up here. Jared don't even want to go fishing anymore. And he was always, always, always fishing. And nobody really wants to go anywhere into the wilderness, so to speak, too far from home.
Well, I can understand why they don't want to go back into the wilderness when you know you have dogmen running around. Well, Clara, thanks again so much for your time coming on the show tonight and sharing that experience with us. I'm so sorry you had to go through that. Hopefully you won't have anything like that happen to you again.
Well, I hope not, Vic, but you're the man I'll call if I do. You're doing an excellent job again. As I said, trying to keep this show running on the radio or on YouTube and awareness. Wake up, people. You're not alone out there.
That's right. That's good advice. And you know, if you do have any other experiences, I'm not going anywhere. I'll be here for you.
I know you will, Vic. I know. I really appreciate you getting right back to me. Within hours, I heard from you. So I really appreciate it. And I urge anybody who's had these sightings to please, please call in and share your stories, because this is the only way people are going to believe and understand. And I compliment everybody that's been on your shows. We've listened and we will continue to listen to your show. And we just sit there and say, oh, there's another one. And you just wish it didn't happen to them. But I thank you for all your help and all your guidance and your advice. And knowing you're there makes me sleep a lot better.
Well, thanks for the good words, Claire. I just wish I could do more. A lot of the time, it feels like I'm not able to do much at all, actually.
You're making the public aware.
I'm trying. Well, thanks again so much for your time, Clara. Have a great night.
You too, Vic, and thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Bye. If you've had a dogman encounter of your own and would like to speak with me, whether in private or on the show, please go to dogmanencounters.com and submit a report. I'd love to hear from you.